Welcome to this lecture on energy efficient building concepts. In this lecture, I will take you on a short journey through a few concepts that are used a lot in the area of sustainable and energy efficient buildings. They are used by policymakers, architects and designers, and sometimes also as a brand for marketing. The idea behind these concepts is to offer concrete products and steps towards more sustainability. But what do I mean by building concept? Let's define it as being the total of a coherent group of measures taken at building level, building site level, or even at the level of the energy system. First, let me remind you of the energy chain, in which primary energy is used to supply electricity, heat, cold, and various renewable and non-renewable fuels to a building. See the white building in the picture below. The fuels being supplied to the energy conversion system inside the building and above the heat, electricity and cold supply. Energy efficient building concepts rely on this energy chain. What we haven't shown yet in this energy chain is the possibility to generate energy in the building itself or on the building site and to transport and sell it to the grid. It is possible to deliver energy back to the grid and for the building itself to act as an energy producer. See the black arrow on the slide. An example of this would be if a building has a lot of solar panels and does not use all the electricity that these solar panels generate. It is technically possible to sell this surplus electricity to the grid. Let's take a closer look at this on the building or building site level. We now have a building in orange. Please be aware that the building now looks like a house, but it could also be an office building, a school, a data center, or any type of building. You see on the right the energy demand, which is determined by the wish to maintain a certain temperature and by construction characteristics like insulation. Left, we see the energy delivered to the site. The HVAC systems distribute this electricity, heat and cold inside the building. In these HVAC systems, electricity, heat and cold can also be made based on incoming fuels. Think, for instance, of a home gas boiler. This is what the dark blue arrow represents. But you also see that renewable energy may be produced on site. Think of solar photovoltaic panels on the roof of the building. Think of a small wind turbine placed in the lawn belonging to the house. Both will produce electricity. Another example of production on site may be the excess heat produced by a data center or a geothermal source located on the house plot. Concerning cold production, it may be the cold well of an aquifer thermal storage or a lake. In general, the energy generated on-site is used first in the building itself. But at certain moments of the day, there is no need for this energy, and there is not enough storage capacity on-site for it either. The excess energy can be exported to the grid or to other buildings that do have an energy demand. That is what happens in so-called smart grids with electricity, but also with heating or cooling. By injecting renewable energy into these grids, the share of renewable energy used increases and the grids themselves become more sustainable. There is a lot of research on how to design these smart grids. However, the biggest issue at the moment may be the one of policy. In many countries, it is forbidden to export energy to the grid. There are in general two reasons for this, the first one being stability and controllability issues. The second one relates to economic issues around monopolies for energy delivery and taxes and cost agreements about buying and delivering energy to the net. So be aware that at the moment this may not be possible in your country. Now, let's take a look at 9 different building concepts. Passive and active buildings, net zero and nearly zero energy buildings, positive energy buildings, zero energy and CO2 neutral buildings, circular buildings, and finally, healthy buildings. Let's start with passive buildings. The main idea in this concept is to reduce energy demand as much as possible. This way, the energy delivered to the site is strongly reduced as well. Look at the picture. You see the reduction in demand and in energy delivered. You also see that the insulation of the house has increased a lot. We speak of a passive building if the yearly energy demand for space heating is below 15 kWh per square meter. The total energy demand for space heating, appliances, hot tap water, etc. should be below 60 kWh per square meter. To achieve this, a high level of insulation is needed. High efficiency glazing should be used and ventilation systems should apply heat recovery. In fact, such a house should be able to create a good indoor comfort with almost no heating or cooling system. The heat produced by appliances like laptops and lighting and the heat produced by human activities should be enough to heat the house. From the cooling point of view, the house should be designed in such a way that no cooling system is needed. Using cold night air or air cooled down in pipes in the ground should be enough. The second concept we look at is completely different. We call it an active building. And the idea here is that if we use infinite renewable sources of energy, we don't need to reduce the energy demand that much. We'd better put all attention to the smart functioning of what we would call a multi-commodity system. Basically, the energy demand is left for what it is, and the attention is put on increasing the use of renewables. Look at how the picture will change. The amount of renewables on-site and off-site increases, and smart controls are used to make the best use of it. This includes controls inside the building, think for instance of solar blind controls, and also playing with energy market prices, when to buy and sell which type of energy. Unfortunately, many active buildings would consider only cost optimization, but there is a large potential to extend the controls towards minimum primary energy and minimum CO2 emissions. Net zero energy buildings, so-called NZEB, are based on the achievement of a balance between the energy delivered to the site and renewable energy produced and used on-site. In net zero energy buildings, energy delivered to the site must be equal to renewable energy produced on-site. This concept takes into account the fact that renewable energy is intermittent. It recognizes that the possibilities vary from hour to hour and from season to season. For instance, solar electricity is produced during the day while you need lighting at night. Solar boilers produce a lot of it in summer while you need space heating in winter. Without the use of large batteries or the use of energy from the grid, it is currently very difficult to bridge this mismatch between supply and demand, especially in cold countries. There are many definitions of net zero energy buildings. It is not a standardized term, so make sure all partners in a project have a clear idea what exactly you mean. First, the renewable part of the energy delivered to the site may or may not be taken into account. Think of green certificates for electricity or geothermal district heating. Second, the renewable energy generated on-site may be defined as energy produced and used on-site, or even as energy produced, used, and exported. Third, in some definitions, not all energy is accounted for, but only electricity or only heating or cooling. Let's move on to the nearly zero energy buildings. Please be aware that the abbreviation is also NZEB, the same as for the net zero energy buildings, which is very confusing. In these buildings, a small deviation of the yearly balance is accepted, meaning that producing a bit less renewable energy on site than is needed to balance the energy delivered to the site is allowed. How large this small deviation is depends very much from national and local agreements, if any. For instance, European guidelines indicate a maximum imbalance of 45 kWh per square meter. Just like for the net zero energy buildings, many different definitions can be found. A positive energy building is just the opposite of a nearly zero one. The balance carries on the other side, and now more energy is produced by on-site renewables than delivered to the site. Of course, all these NZEB and positive energy buildings are very nice ideas, but in the end, fossil fuels are still consumed in these concepts, and we want to aim for buildings that are completely fossil-free. We will call them zero energy buildings. Be careful here as well, because some people use the term ZEB but mean NZEB. There are two main definitions for ZEB buildings. In the first one, the building site is allowed to receive energy from outside, but this energy should be 100% based on renewables. In the second definition, only on-site renewable energy is accepted, making the use of storage and batteries on-site necessary. As zero-energy buildings use only renewable energy, they produce no carbon emissions during the operation of the energy systems and can therefore be called carbon-neutral buildings as well. They are also sometimes referred to as zero-carbon buildings or net-zero-carbon buildings. It would be even better if not only the energy usage would be carbon-free, but also if all construction materials, processes, and the materials used in the HVAC systems were carbon-free. We would then speak about circular buildings where a life cycle approach is used. How are the materials produced, transported, and how they are processed at the end of the lifetime of the building? Finally, it is worth mentioning the concept of healthy buildings. This is related to energy, as indoor health is partly determined by indoor air quality and therefore by ventilation flow rates that also greatly influence energy demand. It is also partly determined by the quality of natural light and artificial lighting, and it is also determined by the quality of the materials used in the construction and the finishing. This should not emit any substances that are harmful to people. Some definitions of circular buildings do include healthy buildings. However, healthy buildings may include a broader view on health, including, for instance, incentives to have exercise or to eat healthy. To summarize, we have reviewed 9 energy efficient building concepts. Some are about the building itself and others more about the supply of energy. In many of them, the concept is about using renewables and fossil fuels in equal shares. Finally, some concepts go for the complete elimination of fossil fuels and CO2 emissions, and this may even include building materials and health.